Well, that dressing room unrest over a perceived slight that never was has become a full-on uprising. Now, I have to sort it out on deadline day, and I am still not over it. Greetings, my excellent friends, and welcome back to Club 3, Part 13 of the Director of Moneyball. I'm Kirk Sheridan, and I have not seen dynamics this bad in my entire career as Director of Football. I've managed to recover the situation with most of the players who were upset in the last episode about that contract offer that never was, but actually was, but they thought wasn't. Yes, it makes as much sense to me as well. But Onana is not one of them, because not only was he upset about that situation, but when we offered him out for transfer and turned down a couple of offers because we wanted to get a higher value, he felt that we had broken a promise to him. So we've now let him join Sevilla on loan for a cut price fee of just £400,000 this season. They do have an optional future fee of £5 million as well, which I'm really hoping they'll take him up on, because every other player in the team is supporting him. They're taking his side over mine. The only players who aren't supporting him are basically the brand new signings who don't know any better. So needless to say, the impact of this little glitch where my players got upset that I didn't offer somebody a contract that I promised to because I'd already offered it, this could be problematic for the rest of the season. Not only that, but Fabian Reda is upset because he still wants to join Real Madrid. Mansverk is now wanted by Atletico Madrid. And Fischer and Santiago both want to move out on loan, or even a permanent move. And to make matters worse, I've got 15 hours to sort all this out. It's deadline day, we've got £50 million nearly to spend and £200,000 of wage budget to play with. So basically, this episode, anything could happen. And amazingly, despite that whole series of unfortunate events transpiring since the last episode, we've actually only played one match. A 0-0 draw away at Stoke City in the Premier League. Quite even match momentum. No team really looked like they were threatening, but Christensen had a cracking game. Vinicius at left back as well performed incredibly well. And two new signings, Keiki and Sucic, both got sevens. Next up, we have Fulham at home in 8 days' time. And then, on the 13th of September, the big one, our first ever match in the Champions League. And we have actually been handed a pretty tough draw, unexpectedly, given the quality of teams we're going to be facing, I suppose. But we've got Bayern Munich, Real Madrid, Monaco, Fiorentina, Ajax. We're actually opening with one of our most winnable matches. Realistically, Dinamo Zagreb, FC Copenhagen and Molde are probably the only matches we've got a chance of winning in this competition this season. Whether that's going to be enough to get through to the knockout rounds, who knows? But I'm still pushing to improve the squad to give us a better chance in that competition and, of course, in the Premier League. And I've gone back to one of my favourite Moneyball principles of raiding relegated clubs. We already picked up Hannibal from Brighton this season. I've now gone in for Tamindu Bruce Smith, who is a fantastic looking left back, would come in with higher quality than Vinicius, already a good Premier Division player with room to improve. And despite only being 20, he's got 3 years of regular first team football already under his belt. So I'm very much looking forward to this. He's so good, in fact, he's already been capped twice by England, and he was wanted by Real Madrid until just a couple of days ago. So he's considering his decision. The only downside is we've allowed Brighton to sign a replacement first before they let him go, so pressure on them to finish some of their business in the next 15 hours. In other transfer news, we have also moved on Sonny Finch. Of course, he was the hero of our promotion season with 24 goals in the Championship. And although he only started 7 matches last year in the league, he did score 7 times. But now that we've brought in Vitor Roque, we've got Arteza and Roque fighting it out for that one striking berth. So a £3.5 million profit on Finch was basically too much to turn down. He is off to Gladbach in the Bundesliga. But I don't think I'm done. I'm still looking for an improved first-choice goalkeeper. And I really want a hard-tackling central defensive midfielder as well. So let's hope our scouts and agents can rustle up some interesting activity on this probably quite stressful deadline day. Right, it's taken just a couple of hours, but we have an offer for Joachim Fischer from Nottingham Forest. He's valued £24 to £33 million. We've got him listed for loan. They're offering £15.25 million with 20% of the next sale. I don't have to let him go. He would prefer to move on, but I don't want to let him go for a cut price fee, so I'm going to try a £20 million upfront fee and 40% of the total next sale. And they've accepted. Excellent. Well, he is apparently not interested in joining them, so we'll leave it to him and hopefully they can convince him. If they can afford to pay £20 million for him, hopefully they can put together an attractive package for him as well. But I'm absolutely rejecting these offers for Santiago. There is absolutely no way I'm sending him on loan for nothing, given his current value. 2 hours later, and Fisher has unsurprisingly rejected Nottingham Forest. So we go again and offer him out. And 46 minutes later, Santiago has agreed a deal to join Montpellier on loan. We are getting a decent, healthy fee for him this time. So we've confirmed that deal, and he is supposed to be on loan until the end of the season, but I will be keeping a very close eye. And if he starts playing very well, we'll definitely be bringing him back in the winter. 10 hours left and some more outgoing news. Samuel Smith, our 22-year-old fullback, who never really managed to break into the first team. His contract's up at the end of the season, so I'm letting him go for a bit of a cut price, £1.7 million deal, but I'd rather that than risk nothing at the end of the year. But we don't yet have Bruce Smith confirmed to take his place in the squad because Brighton haven't yet signed a replacement. Come on, Brighton, do some good business and do it quickly. Well, it took about another 3 hours, but Brighton did it. They signed Rhys Norrington-Davies, and we have signed Tamindu Bruce-Smith. He comes in not only as the best left-back at the club, but potentially the second-best player in the whole squad. His value shot up to £75 to £88 million, and he's our first £100,000 a week player. So I am putting a lot of faith in this lad. The one downside is he does have a £75 million release clause, so I will of course be looking to negotiate that out of the deal as quickly as we possibly can. Right, 6 hours left, and I still haven't found our perfect goalkeeper or defensive midfielder. I'm starting to get a little bit worried, I must be honest. Right, 4 hours to go until deadline, and we do have our new goalkeeper. He's 21 years old. He's not the finished article. He's going to come in as our backup. So I'm very much paying for potential here, but what potential? 5-star potential. He still has a lot of room to develop physically and mentally, but has been playing a decent chunk of football in Mexico, so he's got game time under his belt. So for this season, Christiansen will be our first choice goalkeeper, and Serna will be his backup. And of course, another fantastic Moneyball signing, £7.75 million release clause. And that, my friends, is that. The transfer deadline has passed. We weren't able to find that elusive defensive midfielder, so I will continue scouting throughout the autumn, and hopefully we'll be able to make a move for someone in the winter. But it's interesting to see, for the first time in a long time, we have spent more money than we received in this transfer window. £134 million total received, £153 million spent. But I am very much convinced those are wise investments in players whose value will only increase and allow us to invest further on quality players in the very near future. We still have only the 12th highest expenditure on wages in the division, and we're still expected to finish in that 11th place. And in fact, we were actually the biggest spenders in the Premier League in that transfer window. Brought 9 players in, but shipped 38 players out, either released, loans, or sales. Wow. We have been busy. And now comes one of the trickiest tasks that I've faced. It's a shame that I can't delegate this one to Antony Clarke. I now have to pick our squad for the Champions League. And here is that final squad. And the big news is some major players had to miss out because of this homegrown at club rule. I had to include 3 players who I otherwise might not have done. Philip Rowley, Jared Latham, and Philip French. French is probably one who might have made it in as a third choice goalkeeper. But Rowley and Latham are just nowhere near ready yet. But obviously, I have to make sure that we've got the numbers in to fill the squad. So that means Cordero has missed out. Fisher has missed out. New goalkeeper Serna has missed out. So he's only going to be a backup in English competitions. And most controversially, Emirhan Ilkan has missed out. He joined us for £7.5 million last year. I still have high hopes. Did not really set the Premier League alight. But I hope he's not too frustrated about not being selected for the Champions League squad. So, lesson learned, I need to put a major focus on youth players and develop them if we've got any chance of being competitive in the Champions League. But before we trek across Europe, we have Fulham at home in the Premier League. We're expecting a 52,888 person sellout. We're favourites, but board and supporters are both expecting a draw, so they're probably aware of some of this unrest in the dressing room and wondering what impact it might have on Antony Clarke's team. I have tried everything possible to improve these dynamics. I've been praising players for training well this week just to try and bump things up a little bit. But it's now out of my hands. I pass this team on to you, Antony Clarke. And I've just noticed this next match is his 99th in charge of Everton, which means my first match as a Champions League director of football will be Antony Clarke's 100th match in charge of Everton. Oh, this is beautiful. It's poetry, and it's these kind of stories that make me love Football Manager. And we do pick up another 3 points. It was a tight match. Apparently the quality of finishing was poor throughout. And in fact, it was one of our midfielders who scored the winner. Slightly concerning there to see that Fulham had the better momentum throughout most of the game, even though we were the home team. And our goal itself came from some great work from Vitor Roque. He capitalised on a bit of a defensive slip there to cross the ball for Reader to knock in at the near post. Excellent combination there with Reader bursting forward into the box. And in fact, some fantastic performances all round from our team. Good to see Bruce Smith coming in and putting in a 7.1 on his debut at left back. That result keeps us unbeaten in the league. 2 wins from the first 3 matches. We're sitting in 5th place, but now we move our attention, incredibly, to the Champions League. And shockingly, apparently, we are favourites for this match against Dinamo Zagreb. This might be based on a fan and pundit poll, though, so I'm not sure how much we should trust that vote. But just before we move into that huge European night, I'm going to change subjects somewhat and just let the tension and the atmosphere build. While I point out how well our under-21s team is doing this season, we've played 7 matches, won 5, drawn 2, and got a goal difference of plus 13. Top of the under-21 Premier 1, and I think a major reason for that is that a huge chunk of our first team squad are eligible for the under-21s this season. 14 players aged between 18 and 21 who are knocking on the door of at least, if not already, first team regulars. And you can see this borne out in the results that we've been getting. A lot of first team goal scorers. So we're using this as an opportunity to rotate the team massively and make sure that they're match fit at all times. And you can see just how young this squad is looking at this comparison screen. The average age of the players in the Premier League is 27.18, and ours are not even 24. If we can keep at least some of these players together for a decent period of time, if we can avoid Rule 9 destroying what we're building, we could achieve enormous things as this squad just get better and better. But enough of that, I won't make you wait any longer. It's the big one, it's game day, it's European night, it's Dinamo Zagreb versus Everton in the Champions League. I still can't quite believe we're here. Look at the quality of clubs we're going up against in this competition. Bayern Munich, Barcelona, Napoli, Real Madrid, Juventus, PSG. This is amazing. And who has Clarke put his faith in for this game? We have Christiansen in goal, a back four of Bruce Smith, Keiki, Vico and Koskin, none of whom were regulars in our defence last season, so that is big changes at the back. Lado is supporting Susic and Hannibal in midfield, with Rukavina, McNamee and Roque up front. And that really shows you the extent of our transfer business this summer. Only 3 of our starting lineup in our first match in the Champions League were here last season. And that just means we've got a spectacularly powerful bench, which is brilliant. And I cannot wait to see how this team perform. Antony Clarke, come on, achieve great things. Imagine what it would be like if we can win our first match away from home in the Champions League. Oh, an early injury there for Rukavina, it looks like. His condition dropped spectacularly there. I'm still feeling a bit nervous. I must be honest, I'm concerned about the fact that we didn't find a defensive midfielder. The one thing that I feel that we are missing in this team is a real enforcer in central midfield. Don't get me wrong, Lado is brilliant, and as a playmaker at the back, he can really control the game. He's generally in the right place to pick up passes and doesn't really lose possession very often. But he is a more creative player, as well, by his natural ability. and he would prefer to be playing as a playmaker, whereas we generally set up with a defensive midfielder. So I've spent a lot of the summer looking for that midfield general. Old school hard tackling midfielder. Rukavina is through. Oh my word. And the referee is going to be looking at this one. The ball came over the top. A goal that we've seen Rukavina score plenty of times before. And it is awarded. Fantastic. So who got that assist? That was Lado. There we go. Talking about his playmaking abilities. And an incredible finish there for Rukavina. So far, things are looking good. We're holding our own. Well, we're more than holding our own. 1-0 up away from home against Dinamo Zagreb. This is a nice way to be spending an evening. Given that I'm on holiday, technically, for this match. Maybe I'm watching this on the beach. Maybe sat next to a pool. And another ball over the top. Roque is in. Rounds the goalkeeper. And an amazing finish from Roque. I thought he ran it too far and that the defender would make it back to clear off the line. But no, he found the bottom corner. And it was Hannibal that time with a ball over the top. It does look like Zagreb are very susceptible to that lofted through ball. And I'm not complaining. So against this team, we're not seeming to struggle without a defensive midfielder. Against other teams, when we come to play Real Madrid, when we come to play Monaco, Bayern, it's going to be a different story, I think. And that's just ridiculous. Look at this. I hope you saw that before it flashed away. In the 39th minute of the first match of the season, Everton atop of the Champions League group table. Not going to happen again, ever, probably. And is this a penalty? That looks like that might be a penalty. We might be getting our third goal here. The referee is certainly having it checked. So who's stepping up to take this penalty now? Is it Rukavina? It is. And it's a good save, actually, from the Zagreb goalkeeper. But it's played back to Koskun. And it's just past the post. The goalkeeper did manage to get a touch to it. So Roque with the corner. Can we go 3-0 up by half-time? Well, not from that effort, but we've got another corner. We're putting relentless pressure on. This is incredible to see. I genuinely thought this young team, this very young team, would be quite overawed by this occasion. But they're playing absolutely out of their skins. They haven't let it faze them at all. And in fact, we're on the ball again. Keiki this time at the back plays it to Sucic, who's dropping deep. Keiki again to Vico, to Hannibal, to Sucic. And another lofted through ball, beautifully weighted for Roque. That time, the goalkeeper stands tall, but it is another corner. We could run away with this in the second half. Now Roque taking the corner, floats it into the far post. Cleared out, Rukavina picks it up, but it's cleared by the defender. Only as far as Lado, Keiki to Sucic, who winds up and spins the shot high and wide. In fact, no, it's another corner. Ridiculous amounts of pressure. Absolutely ridiculous. How many corners has Roque taken? Orteza now with a corner, and it's off third. Orteza to Keiki. I'm loving life as a Champions League director of football. This is absolutely great. I didn't believe that we were favourites for this match. I now understand why. We've now lost our spot at the top of the Champions League, though. That's devastating. We're now only third in the Champions League group table. I mean, that's just not good enough, really, is it? We should be pushing for the top after a game like this. Oh dear, are they going to get a consolation, though? No, Christensen does stand tall. 90 minutes gone into injury time. And a 3-goal victory and a clean sheet in Everton's first match in the Champions League. That, my friends, is more than I could have possibly imagined. Just look at these match stats. What an incredible performance. Absolutely relentless momentum. 7-plus ratings all over the pitch. And given we missed a penalty, we probably should have scored 4. And my word, £2 million just for winning a football match. That Champions League has a lot of money. Worryingly, though, Roque has pulled his knee ligament, so he's going to be out for 2 to 3 weeks, although Rukavina is only out for a week. But there is no way that Antony and I are going to let that put a dampener on our celebrations. I can promise you, 2 years ago, when I sat down with Antony Clarke and offered him the job as Everton head coach, after we'd just been relegated to the Championship, neither of us thought in our wildest dreams that about 27 months later, we would be playing Champions League football. 100 matches managed for Everton now and 66 games won. only 19 losses in that time. This guy is a legend. It doesn't feel fair, does it? I'm on the favoured personnel list, but it really should be Antony Clarke. So, Sports Interactive, if you are listening, please, just for FM24, if you could give the assistant manager a bit more prominence when you're playing as a director of football to get onto that favoured personnel list, that would be very much appreciated, because Antony Clarke just totally deserves it, and I want to see him rewarded. So now the hard work starts for Antony Clarke. We're 4 matches unbeaten at the start of the season, but there's some tough fixtures coming up. We've got Liverpool at home in the Premier League. We've got Bayern Munich at home in the Champions League. We're going away to Ajax at the start of November. These are huge fixtures, and we will return soon to show you just how good this Everton team is holding up across multiple competitions, and whether, just maybe, we can hold on to these ridiculous league positions for a couple more months. I'm not expecting it, but with Antony Clarke in charge, honestly, anything seems possible. So I hope you've enjoyed what you've watched today. If you have, please drop a like on the video and subscribe to the channel. Turn your notifications on to find out the second the next part drops. And in the meantime, be excellent to each other. I'm Kirk Sheridan. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you soon.